Well, welcome to Bentry Online. I'm so glad that you're with us today. And it's an exciting morning here as we get ready for worship. We're going to have some time to get to sing together, pray together, open God's word together. And I'm Matt Smith, the engagement pastor here at Bentry. Before we go into the worship center, I just want to prepare you for a little bit of what to expect today. We're going to get to celebrate baptisms, the reality of people putting their faith in Jesus and then wanting to publicly display that. And so we get to have a time during the service where we're going to celebrate with all those who have put their faith in Jesus and are taking the step and have obedience to be baptized. I can't wait to worship together during that part. And if you're joining in and it's you're joining in because you have a family member that is being baptized, let us know in the chat, whether you're on Facebook or on our live stream, and we would love to celebrate with you during that time. Also, we have one of Libin's friends, Ryan Leek, is here to teach this morning, and he's going to be giving us a message on what it would look like to live undefendable and how that's even possible as we put our faith in Jesus and look to him and allow him to really express his life through us to the people around us. And so I'll be praying for us that we'll have our ears attuned to what God has for us and our minds open to understand as we look at what it looks like to trust in Jesus in the relationships that we have with one another in such a divided world, but we can come together as one in Christ and live from that place of unity with him and with one another. So I'm praying for us as we join together, and I'm so glad that you're here. If you're on your own, go ahead and sign in on our live stream page or on Facebook and leave comments. Let us connect that way. If you're joining in with people with you, go full screen and worship together in the space where you are as you worship with us and you're worshiping with the people around you. I'm so thankful that you're here. And now let's go into the worship center and worship together.
Good morning, Bentry family. How we doing? How we doing? Good. You guys hear me? Yeah? Okay, we got someone. Good. Let's stand together. Hey, put your arm around someone next to you and just say, I'm glad you're here. And then just whisper, you smell good too. It's good. It's fine. Hey, well, it's an honor to be in the house of the Lord together to worship this morning. And man, the Pierce household has been filled with one thing over the last 6 months, and it's been Bible characters. All right, our kids are obsessed with Bible characters, and it has nothing to do with me. Our grandparents are super holy and super involved in spreading those stories, but the name that's been going around our house over the last few weeks has been Elijah, okay? Our kids are obsessed with Elijah. But we've been learning about this man who, with his words, spoke to kings. With his words, literally stopped rain from falling. And that same God wants to walk with us. And it culminated this week with my three-year-old standing out in front of our house, calling down a mighty wind and fire to take down our neighbor's Halloween inflatables. Which would have been super cute if our neighbor wasn't standing in the front yard watching all this happen. So it turned into an amazing scent conversation, and chalk that one up. It'll be fine. But man, that's our God. There's power in our words. There's power in when the Holy Spirit breathes something in your heart for you to speak it out. And so that's what this morning worship is about. Every song we have, everything we're about to sing is a declaration of who he is, what he's done, and what he's still doing in our families, in our marriages, in our city. So as we sing, man, it's more than words. Lean in with your heart. Lean in with your mind and strength. And man, on top of that, we got baptisms. We got our man Ryan Leek here to preach. It's going to be a fantastic morning. So let's worship. You guys good? Come on. Let's go.
Where we hear praises, he. Christ is my firm foundation. He's the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that
Sing this out. Rain came. Safe with Jesus, that's our declaration this morning, is that you are a faithful King. God, you hear the cries of your people. You're near the brokenhearted. So, Holy Spirit, even as we celebrate hearts this morning that have given their trust to you, Father, would you awaken that same trust in our own hearts? Man, would you remind us where we were before we met you, Jesus? Would you remind us of the trajectory our life was on before you came crashing in with your story and your kingdom? Holy Spirit, we gotta have you this morning. It's all we want, because it's all we need. We pray that in your beautiful name. Amen.
Amen. What beautiful reminders of God's truth this morning. Thank you, worship team. You guys may be seated. Well, good morning, church. My name is Marcel Hamilton, and I am so excited to celebrate baptisms and share these testimonies with you today. These are members of our body proclaiming that Christ is indeed their firm foundation in life. Just as a reminder, we believe that baptism does not save you, but it's a physical expression of a spiritual reality. We have been buried with Christ and raised with him to new life. Braylee Matthews. Braylee is 6 years old. Recently, she talked to her mom about Jesus and who he is and what it means that Jesus is God. Her mom answered her questions and explained that one day Braylee would be ready to choose to become a follower of Jesus. Braylee didn't want to wait and prayed to accept Jesus. She has been excitedly telling family and friends that she is now a Christian. Braylee wants everyone to know that she is a follower of Jesus, and that is why she is getting baptized today. Braylee will be baptized by her mom.
Have you put your trust in Christ and Christ alone for your salvation?
Yes.
Then because of your profession of faith, your mom now baptizes you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Bodie Smith. Bodie was at basketball 2 years ago and heard about how Jesus died for his sins. He went and talked it over with the speaker, and that is when his faith started. Bodie is grateful to the Bentry staff and others who have helped him understand who Jesus is. Jesus gets Bodie through tough times and helps him stay calm. Bodie knows that Jesus's love for him is extraordinary. Bodie is ready to be baptized and doesn't want to hold anything back from Jesus. Bodie is joined with his family and will be baptized by Will Raines.
All right, Bodie, have you put your trust in Christ and Christ alone for your salvation? Yeah. All right, there's one excitement that we baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, buried with him in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in new life.
Ella Van Aken. Ella is 10 years old and in the fifth grade. She learned about Jesus from her parents reading the Bible and by going to church. She has wanted to be baptized since learning about Jesus and has been asking for a long time. She knows that Jesus will help her to be a better person. She wants to tell her friends about Jesus. Ella will be baptized by Pastor Jessica Schaller.
Ella, have you put your trust in Christ and Christ alone for your salvation? Yes, awesome. Then it is because of your profession of faith that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Walk in new life.
Gavin Van Aken. Gavin has attended church his whole life. He started middle school this year and is in the sixth grade. He learned about Jesus from his parents when they read the children's Bible together. Jesus has made a positive impact in his life. He wanted to be baptized for many years and is excited to publicly declare his faith today. Gavin will be baptized by Pastor Kevin Rund.
All right, Gavin, have you put your faith in Jesus and Jesus alone for your salvation?
Yes.
Awesome. Based on that profession, it is my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Walk in new life. Congrats, man.
Eric Palmer. Eric is 10 years old and is in the fifth grade. He accepted Jesus into his heart in April 2017. He learned about Jesus at Bent Tree and from his parents. Jesus means everything to Eric, and he is ready to take this next step by being baptized. Eric will be baptized by his dad.
Eric, have you put your trust in Christ and Christ alone for your salvation? Awesome, you're so excited. Then your dad now baptizes you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Walk in new life. Yeah, you go that way. Are you good?
Sophia Palmer. Sophia is a 10th grader. She has attended Bent Tree all her life and learned about Jesus in the ministries here and from her dad. She asked Jesus into her heart in March 2016. Since high school, she has seen the wonderful ways the Lord works through people. She wants to keep growing in her faith and share with others the good word. Sophia will be baptized by her dad.
Sophia, have you put your trust in Christ and Christ alone for your salvation? Awesome. Then your dad now baptizes you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Walk a new life.
Elizabeth Palmer. Elizabeth and her family have been attending Bent Tree for 15 years. She grew up in East Germany and started attending church when she came to the United States as a foreign exchange student. Through her host family, she came to faith in Christ and met her husband. After placing her faith in Jesus, the biggest change that Elizabeth noticed in her life has been her ability to release her worries to Jesus and ask him for guidance through prayer. Now she confidently asks Jesus for direction and then releases the challenges she faces into his hands, trusting that he will take care of things. Elizabeth wants to be baptized today to take the next step in her journey with Jesus and proclaim her love for him. Elizabeth will be baptized by her husband.
Elizabeth, have you placed your faith in Christ and Christ alone?
I have.
Then your husband, Scott, baptizes you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now go and walk in newness of life.
Dominic Coleman. Dominic accepted Jesus in his heart when he was 7 years old when he was at Sky Ranch summer camp. Today, as he goes underwater, he is remembering and celebrating the rebirth of Jesus Christ and the cleansing of sins that has changed him. As we witness the public display of Dominic's dedication to God, he knows that the Holy Spirit is shining through him onto others. Dominic will be baptized by Pastor Kevin Rund.
All right, Dominic, you ready?
Yeah.
Awesome. Have you put your faith in Jesus and Jesus alone for your salvation?
Yes, I have.
Awesome. Based on that profession, it is my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. There we go. Walk in new life.
Emma Pinkston. Emma grew up in a religious household and always knew about God, but didn't truly know him. After experiencing the heart-wrenching loss of her mother, she turned to God and her life has been changed ever since. Today, Emma wants to declare publicly that she trusts in Jesus and that she's ready to dedicate her life to the Lord. Emma will be baptized by Pastor Antoine Malone.
Emma, have you put your faith and trust in Christ and Christ alone for your salvation? Very cool. All right. Well, your husband is going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ and raised to walk in a brand new life. All right, man.
Kaylee Andrews. Kaylee has attended Bent Tree since she was 10 years old and grew up hearing about God. For years, she heard worship music and sermons, but nothing ever stuck with her. As she grew older, life became more difficult. Family life grew increasingly complicated. Mental health issues showed up and medical complications were promising she would never be able to have children. But God was not finished with her story. One day, God used the faithful witness of a good friend, and suddenly it all clicked. God had become more obvious in her life than he'd ever been, and now she simply wants to live her best for him. Today, Kaylee wants to tell the world that she is a born-again believer in Christ and is ready to take the next step in her spiritual journey. Kaylee will be baptized by Pastor Antoine Malone.
Kaylee, have you put your trust in Christ and Christ alone for your salvation? Well, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ, and raised to walk in brand new life.
Hannah Schultz. Watching her nephews get baptized last year motivated Hannah to do the same. She wants to publicly say she is a Christian and will follow God and Jesus. She is thankful to her mom, Mary, Talon, and Cody for bringing Bentry to her and renewing her desire to be baptized. Hannah will be baptized by her mom, Marilyn Schultz.
Hannah, have you placed your faith in Christ and Christ alone? Then your mom, Marilyn, baptizes you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now go and walk in newness of life. Congratulations.
Nesta Street. Nesta became a true believer in his 20s. He thought he knew what God meant to people. He was quickly humbled and was shown that God is Lord of the universe, that he does love Nesta and is the hedge over his life through all hills and valleys. Nesta has never been baptized and is excited to do it with his new church family. Nesta will be baptized by Pastor Jim White.
Well, Nesta, I'm so excited for you. Have you placed your faith in Christ and Christ alone?
Yes, I have.
Then I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now go and walk and do this alive, buddy.
Christina Soltzba. Christina grew up in a wonderful Christian home. She was raised in the Lutheran church but was never baptized. She wants to declare her faith in Jesus publicly, especially now that she has children. She wants them to know her beliefs and lead them in truth. Christina will be baptized by Corbin and Maddie Pierce.
Well, Christina, have you placed your faith in Christ and Christ alone? Then Corbin's going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now go and walk in newness of life. Woo!
Come on, can we give Jesus one more Thanksgiving of praise? Come on, he's still resurrecting hearts to life, changing people, transforming homes. We're so thankful for the goodness of God and the power of the gospel. We are not ashamed of the gospel because it is a power of God to save lives. Amen? Amen. Welcome to church today, guys. Come on, welcome. Welcome, everybody. We're glad you're here online in this room. We're so thankful to have these moments with you. I was debating whether to share the story or not, but Stacy and I, we had a name on the wall for about 2 years, and it was her coworker and her husband, and about a year ago when we started the Sent Conversation series, their daughter asked them, who is God? And they had nowhere to begin to answer that question. So they said, we should probably start going to church. So they attended church for about a year. They have no church background at all in their life, in their family. And they were sitting right here with us. And then her husband's job got transferred to Alaska. And so they moved to Alaska about 6 months ago. And last week, they sent us a video of her husband getting baptized in a frozen lake, 12 degrees cold, because they said, we just couldn't wait to follow Jesus any longer. Prayer works, amen? Your sent moments matter. So thank you for being with us. Hey, today, if you're new, if you're visiting Bentry, we're so thankful that you're here. We prayed for you. We pray for the seat you're sitting in. For all of you worshiping with us online, thank you for carving out these moments. And for guests, right after service, right outside these doors at the end of the service, we'll have a guest gathering. If you've got questions for us, if you've got curiosity in your heart about who we are as a church, we would love to meet you and pray with you and help you take the next steps. And all of what you saw today in baptism and all the missions around the world that we get to be a part of, all of that happens because of your giving and your generosity. And these stories are the fruit of you obeying God and stepping into both faith conversations with people and your generosity, and it makes a difference. And so thank you for all of you who give. And if you want to give today or this week or this month, you can scan the QR code in front of the seat in front of you, or go online to bentry.org or on the app. There are many ways to give. And thank you so much for your continued generosity that is changing hearts. I often say, well, it leaves our hand, it never leaves our life, because it is placed into the almighty hands of God, and we're trusting in him to do with our resources far more than what we could ever do with it ourselves. And so, and he takes our resources and he changes the world and he changes lives like you've just seen today. Hey, today's really special, not just because of baptisms, but I got a friend of mine here today who's going to bring God's word to us. His name is Ryan Leake, and I met him right when I started Bentry about a year and a half, almost 2.5 years ago, but I met him right after that through a mutual friend, and I just have become to so love Ryan and his heart for God, his heart for the world, his heart for our community. Ryan wears a lot of different hats. He's a chaplain, he's an author, he's an executive coach. All the largest corporations in the world seek him out to come and speak at their largest events to train and to develop. He's also a teaching pastor. He's a preacher. He's a teaching pastor at several great churches, especially here in our city. So I don't know how one person can do all of that, but he does. But the greatest thing he is that he's a child of God. He's a great husband to his wife, Amanda, and a great dad to two incredible boys. And today, I've asked Ryan to come and give us a message that's on his heart, something that he's been really passionate about and has written a book that he'll share a little bit about as well. So, Bentry, will you put your hands together and welcome my friend, Ryan Leake, on the platform today.
Appreciate you. Bentry, how we doing today? It is an absolute privilege to be here. The last time I was in this building, I was telling Living this earlier, it was about 9 years ago. I was here at a leadership conference, and I remember sitting in that lobby asking God what in the world he wanted to do with my life, and I had a lot of questions. And I want to say this, walking into this building today, I think sometimes God brings you to specific places to remind you of his goodness and remind you of his faithfulness. And so I stand here today pretty proud of what God has been able to do in my life. And I just am so grateful to Libin for giving me an opportunity to share God's word with you. You're in church today. You're giving us about an hour or so of your day. And that's a really, really big deal. And I believe that today's message is absolutely going to change your life. Not because I think it's that good. I think today's message is going to change your life because I think God is that good. Now, a couple of things you need to know about me before we jump into today's message is number one, I am married. This is a picture of my wife. Now, when people see a picture of my wife, they typically think to themselves, how in the world did he get her? Let me explain. So when my wife and I were dating, I overheard her tell a friend that she thought it would be cool to get engaged and married on the same day. I had absolutely no idea what that meant. So I guessed and began planning our wedding behind her back over the course of 2 years. I was in 11 weddings before I was ever in my own. Apparently, I was a good friend in college because people I barely knew kept asking me to be in their wedding. Nevertheless, I would bring my girlfriend to each wedding and I would take copious notes on everything that she liked and didn't like about each wedding. The 11th wedding was about 3 weeks before I had this engagement planned, and the groom walks up to me and says, "Hey, I hear you're doing a surprise wedding." I said, "It's a surprise. Keep your voice down." He said, "Hey man, whatever you do, don't mess up the cake." I said, "Dude, it's just cake. It's not that big of a deal." He said, "Dude, trust me, you don't want to mess up the cake." So I meander on over to Amanda at the time and I said, "Hey babe, what do you think about this cake here?" She goes, "Eh, it's okay. But I got a better one on Pinterest." I didn't know what Pinterest was. So I go to Pinterest and I type in Amanda Roman, and a board pops up entitled My Dream Wedding. and it had 242 photos of everything that she would want in a wedding. And I thought to myself, this would have been helpful 2 years ago. Nevertheless, June 7, 2013, I get down on one knee. I say, Amanda, will you marry me? She said, yes. I said, just kidding. Will you marry me today? And we opened up a lounge room door, and about 85 of our family and friends were standing in there with a sign that said, today. We rolled in a dress, hairstylist, makeup artist, everything that you would need to get engaged and married on the same day. We were engaged for a real long time, a solid 11 hours, and I had a friend film the whole thing. It's called The Surprise Wedding. You can check that out on YouTube a little bit later. We started the baby-making process right away. We have two children. Here are our kids. This is Jackson and Roman. Jackson's 8 years old. He's running around the church at this very moment. I have no idea where he is, but I'm sure he is safe. And Roman is our wonderful four-year-old. Now, as Livin told you earlier, I'm what some people call a pastorpreneur. I get to do some pastoring and I get to do some entrepreneuring, if you will, and get an opportunity to speak all over corporate America throughout the week and get to teach God's word on the weekend. And here's what I've learned. Working with people that spend a great deal of time with their faith and are all in church, and some people that just aren't. They don't know God. They don't care about God. And I get an interesting perspective on both worlds, if you will. And here's what I've noticed. People are mad. People are angry. And sometimes I'm just like, but why are you so mad? Like, who are you actually mad at? And I can just tell you this, okay? I'm a prophet. I figured that out, okay? I'm a prophet. I'm going to prove it to you today, all right? I'm not a false prophet. I'm a real prophet, all right? Are you ready for this? I'm going to predict the future just for a second. 2024 is coming. Boom. Gotcha. See, I told you. I can predict the future. And guess what? It's an election year. And you know what that means? Somebody's going to win the election. I told you. I'm a genius. I'm just predicting the future for you. And potentially, half of our country is potentially going to be mad at the other half, and they're going to be surprised. I just don't think that's a game that you and I have to play. I think that you and I have a world, have families, have friends, have colleagues that we could actually sit across from and adopt a lifestyle that I'm going to encourage you to do today called being unoffendable. And being unoffendable isn't about this idea that you never get offended. Being unoffendable is about this idea that I'm not going to stay offended, because you and I have some holidays coming up. We've got some people that are coming to our house that we've got to gear up for a month ahead of time, just because we know they have one of those personalities that has been gifted with the ability to get on our last nerve. And somebody's clapping like, yes, Thanksgiving is coming. Listen, I just want you to know there is a version of your life where you can actually walk in forgiveness. We don't have to subscribe to a way of living where every 4 years we have to lose friends, colleagues, and family members. Can you imagine if you and I were the kinds of people that say, you know what? I'm going to be the kind of person that makes a decision to walk in forgiveness. I want to show you how. I love this verse in this passage that's found in Matthew chapter 18. And it says, then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he had begun to settle them, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And then it says, but since he did not have the means to repay, his Lord commanded him to be sold along with his wife and children and all that he had in repayment to be made. So the slave fell to the ground, prostrated himself before him, saying, have patience with me and I will repay you everything. And the Lord of that slave felt compassion and released him and forgave him the debt. But that slave went out and found one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And he seized him and began to choke him. You ever choke somebody over a Venmo transaction? This is getting real. You know what I'm saying? And so, and then he sees and began to choke him and saying, pay back what you owe. And then it says, so his fellow slave fell to the ground and began to plead with him, saying, have patience with me and I will repay you. But he was unwilling and went and threw him in prison until he should pay back what was owed. So when his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were deeply grieved and came and reported to their Lord all that had happened. Then summoning him, his Lord said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not also have had mercy on your fellow slave in the same way that I had mercy on you? I love this illustration that Jesus is giving really to Peter. He's going, hey, I just want to let you know how this kingdom work. I want to let you know how things work in my house. I grew up, I want to tell you a little bit about my house, the house that I grew up in. My father was 49 when my mother had me. So my parents were a little bit older. Like there was always that 5-decade gap between us. And my parents, because of our decades of margin, my parents, they always look to me for tech advice, okay? Like, I'm their internet specialist, their cable specialist, and they always call with just stuff. There's always something. Like, I'll never forget, my mom called me 3 times. When your parents are older, if your parents call you 3 times, you think somebody died. You know what I'm saying? And so I step out of a meeting, mom, what's going on? She's like, oh, I just, your sister told me I need to get a Jamal. I said, mom, I don't know what a Jamal is. I don't have time for this. I'm in a meeting. I thought somebody died. Can we please, can my brother, can somebody else help you with this? She goes, no. Your sister told me you got a Jamal and I need a Jamal. I said, mom, I don't even know what a Jamal is, okay? Like, I got to get back into a meeting. She said, Ryan, your sister told me that I need to get rid of my AOL mail and get me a Jamal. I said, mom, you mean Gmail? She said, yeah, that's it. I said, okay, thank you, mom. But yes, it's called Gmail, okay? My parents are old, right? So whenever I would go visit my parents, some of you are like just getting it, like it'll be after service and you'll get the Jamal joke. Listen, so anytime I go visit my parents in Atlanta, my dad, he likes to go to one place, and one place alone, Walmart. Like, that's my dad's jam, okay? My dad had a stroke when I was in the 5th grade, so he couldn't drive most of my life. And so I would always just take him to Walmart. Now, my parents love Walmart so much that they would be in there for a couple hours, so I had to start parking in the hazards to let them know, hey, I'm in a hazardous situation, so I need y'all to hurry up. So I go visit them in Atlanta one time, and I say, hey, Dad, I surprised them. He goes, Ryan, you're here. I go, Dad, it's good to see you. He goes, want to go to Walmart? I'm like, okay, sure, man, let's go to Walmart. So I pack my parents up in the rental car, and we take them to Walmart, and I park in the hazards. I said, hey, don't be here all day. Okay, y'all, I'm going to give y'all 15 minutes. Okay, 15 minutes to get whatever you need. My mom comes out 45 minutes later with some laundry detergent. I went, it took you 45 minutes to get some laundry detergent? Like, it doesn't take that long. And oh, by the way, where's Dad? She goes, I don't know. You lost Dad? Okay, this is a problem. Stay right here. Don't go nowhere. She goes, yeah, I'll just sit right here. I said, please don't go anywhere. I'm looking for my dad in every aisle in Walmart. I said, listen, this brother better have a cart full of stuff. He better have a dresser in there. There better be a TV, a broom. I'm like, why are we here for 90 minutes? I found my dad in the towel aisle. He's got 2 things in his cart, a Snickers bar and a 2-liter of ginger ale. I said, I'm about to blow this place up. What are we doing here? Like, let's go. He goes, I'm looking for your mother. I said, I'm gonna kill somebody. I'm gonna lose my mind. And so I pay for his Snickers bar and his ginger ale, and we go outside, and you already know the rest of the story. My mama, go. She has stolen my rental car. I'm calling her. She's not answering. I look over. My dad's taking his bite of the Snickers bar. I'm like, it's hot outside. I'm like, she finally comes back 20 minutes later. We've been at Walmart 3 hours now. I said, Mom, why did you steal my car? She said, oh, I was thirsty. and I needed to go get something to drink. And I just turned around and went, we're at Walmart. They got more drinks than any other establishment in all of Atlanta. Like, this is the house that I grew up in. This is what Jesus tries to do with parables. He's trying to give us a picture because he comes to the planet and people are going, okay, if you're the Son of God, then what's your dad like? Tell us what your house is like. And here's how he describes his house. Jesus goes, if you really want to know what my house is like, what our kingdom's like, we let stuff go. We're a forgiving house. Because if you understand the economy of what Jesus is talking about, 10,000 talents in today's economy is about $3.4 billion. It's an unforgivable number that this person has no means to repay. Jesus is going, you couldn't pay this back if you tried in a million years. You need a savior. And I volunteer. He goes, in our house, we let stuff go. And here comes Peter. He's going, hey, Jesus, I got a question for you. How many times should I forgive someone who hurts me? Seven times? Rabbis had already taught in ancient Jewish history, and you could look this up, that the amount of times that you should forgive someone is three times. Which makes sense for all of us, right? Three strikes and you're out, right? So here comes Peter. Peter going, Jesus. Jesus, he ain't no regular rabbi. This is the rabbi of all rabbis. You know, this is King of Kings, Lord of Lords. He ain't going with the three. No, no, no. He can't be a three strikes and you're out, Jesus. No, 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 no. You think six? No, no, no. Let's do double what everybody else says plus one. Hey, Jesus, how many times should I forgive somebody sin against me? What are you thinking, boys? Maybe seven times? Jesus goes, nah, 70 times seven. To which Peter's going, that's a whole lot more than three or seven. And if you're not good at math, it's 490 times. Here's the problem with 490, is that you have never in your life been in a fight with anybody and said, this is the 463rd time you left your dirty drawers on the floor. You got 37 more strikes and we're done. You understand me? Nobody is that good at math. There is not one of you that has an Excel spreadsheet on the sins of your spouse. And some of you are going like, you don't know my spouse. Nevertheless, none of us are that good at math. Here's what Jesus is going. He goes, Peter's going, 490. Hey, Jesus, if I tried to keep track of everybody else's offenses and sins against me, what would happen on that journey? Is, well, I'd lose count. To which Jesus is gone. Exactly. That's the point. I got an idea for you. What if you stopped counting? That's why the number is astronomical. It's astronomical on purpose. You and I have a grand opportunity, whether you're a faith person or not, to just make a decision today about your future. About 2024 and 2025 and 2026 and the rest of your life that says, you know what? I think I want my house to be like that. Because I don't want to live my life holding on to a backpack full of offenses, mad at the world. And I want to show you how. The first thing I think that you and I have to do if we truly want to be unoffendable is, number one, I think we have to recognize our own need to be forgiven. Because when most of us think of forgiveness, we don't think about the mirror. We think about all of the people that hurt us. We rarely think about the times that we've done the hurting. When we think about being unoffendable, we think about the people who are offensive. We don't think about ourselves. I love what Romans 5, verses 6 through 8 says. It says, for while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly, for one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Like some of us think, man, during worship, yeah, of course Christ died for me. No, no, no. When you were making the worst decisions of your life, Christ chose you anyways. And I think that for you and I, that's where we are going to find the strength to forgive and let go of the offenses that have hurt us, is by being able to look in the mirror and go, wait a second, I need forgiveness. I need a Savior. I have done some offending. I have a mic on today. I've already offended somebody. Maybe a Walmart lover right now is going, who's this guy? Like on some level. I know that I have done some offending. I'll never forget a guy walked up to me. We had some people over to the house. And he goes, hey, man, Ron, can I talk to you for a second? I said, man, what's going on? He goes, hey, man, I just want to let you know. I forgive you. I'm like, you forgive me? What I do? I ain't do nothing to you. I don't need forgiveness. What are you talking about? I'm awesome. Like what? He goes, man, 5 years ago, you said something that really offended me, and I've been holding on to it, and I just want to let you know, I forgive you. I'm like, okay, well, can you tell me what I said? I'm just curious. He goes, Ryan, that's kind of the funny thing. I don't even remember what you said. I'm like, and here's the deal, like, that's us. It's all of us. Like, maybe you didn't mean to offend someone, but all of us have accidentally offended somebody at some point in our life. And what we needed in that moment was for somebody to give us a break. I know when you think of offensive people, you're thinking of a colleague, you're thinking of a neighbor, you're thinking of, it's the people that work at TSA at the airport. Those are the offensive people. It's like, no. We gotta look at the mirror and go, yeah, I need someone to give me amazing grace. And when we get there, it allows us to do the second thing that I think is vitally important for us to be unoffendable this weekend, and that's to extend the same grace that has been extended to you. I'm not asking you to extend grace to them because they deserve it. I'm asking you to extend grace to them because you didn't deserve it. And here's what you must understand about forgiven people. Forgiven people have a responsibility to forgive. You got something you did not deserve. So this is not about a deserve thing. Like, Ryan, you don't know what they did. You don't know what they said. You don't know how they behaved. You don't know how they looked at me. You don't know how they treat me. You're right. They don't deserve it. But can I ask a question? Who does? Like, who among us says, well, I'm deserving of forgiveness because I'm awesome. Who's that person? Who's the perfect person among us? I love one of the distinctives here at Bentry is understanding that Christ indwells within us, that we literally embody Christ. And it is inseparable that we are one with him, that you and I can literally not find the strength within ourselves to forgive others and walk in forgiveness. But to say, you know what? I'm gonna borrow the strength that I get from Christ to be able to forgive you, not because I'm awesome and I'm just nice and I can just let things go. No, I would rather hold on to bitterness and make you my enemy. But I've decided, somebody decided to forgive me. And I didn't deserve it. So Lord, would you give me the strength to let go of the things that sometimes bother me the most? If you've really been hurt, here's what I want you to know this weekend. Your greatest opportunity to be like Jesus is when you've been hurt. This is not an easy message. It's a difficult one. But if you're hurting today, maybe you knew this, maybe you didn't, you got a really great opportunity to go, you know what? Let me WWJD this thing. What would Jesus do? Well, we know what his house is like. They let people off the hook that don't deserve it. I love what Matthew chapter 5 says, he says, this is how I want you to conduct yourself in these matters. If you enter your place of worship and about to make an offer, you suddenly remember a grudge a friend has against you, abandon your offering. Leave immediately, go to this friend and make things right then and only then. Come back and work things out with God. Jesus is going, hey, your relationship with God, you can't have that without having one with his people. Some of us are kind of like, oh, forget these people. God, I love you. It's going, well, no, actually, those two things are connected. And so the third thing that I think is vitally important for us to be the kinds of people that are unoffendable is to learn to disagree without disrespect. It's one thing for me to oppose your view. It's another thing for me to oppose your personality. Because you'd be surprised what we've learned to live with in our differences. For example, how many of you are outdoorsy people? Just touch some sky. Okay, yeah, all my outdoorsy, all my REI people. This is great. This is awesome. Okay, how many indoorsy people? Okay, you love air conditioning. Yeah, woos. Thank you. I like it. That's awesome. Okay, cat people. How many of you cat people? Okay, all five of you. That's great. Glad you're here. Dog people. Raise your hand. Woo woo. Okay, where my dog's at? That's great. All right, that's awesome. No pet people. You like your house clean? Okay, that's awesome. Glad you're here. Fantastic. Coke people, Pepsi people. Okay, nobody here. All right, Dr. Pepper, okay. Healthy people, mad that I bring up carbonated drinks and all. Okay, that's great. Glad you're here. Walmart people, balling on a budget. Glad you're here, my man, I see you, okay. Target people, all the rich people, that's great. Glad you came to church. Okay, now this one might start a fight. So don't throw anything at anybody, okay? Just so you know, this one's a hot button, probably the hottest button on the planet, just so you know. I don't even know if I want to say it, but I'm gonna do it. iPhone people. Okay, all the Christians, that's great. Android people, all the hostage people that hold iPhone people hostage in group chats and can't leave if we want, and we gotta download another app just to send you a picture. Here's the deal. Isn't it amazing that we all could still come together and go, Christ is my firm foundation? Like, isn't it amazing? Like, we differ on a lot of things, but we don't have to disrespect each other. Where we eat and where we shop and the phone we use, we might disagree, but we don't have to disrespect each other. We don't have to go below the belt. We can play a different game. What you and I have to do, we have to make a decision as to what we're going to do with those other people. The thems, the ones that are opposite of who we are. What are we going to do with them? I'm going to give you a really great option. I'm just warning you ahead of time. Spoiler alert, you're not going to like this option, but I promise you, it's the best option we got. And I think, personally, as a Jesus follower, I think it's brilliant. I think Jesus is a genius. Here's what he says. He says, have you heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. They were literally taught this. They were literally taught it is your God-given duty to hate your enemy. He says, I know you've been taught this, but I tell you, love your enemies, which is like, Jesus, hold on a second. And then, I'm okay with love your enemies because you can do that, you know, like way over there. It's like, yeah. But this next part, I'm going, wait, pray for those who persecute you? Who would do that? A Christian. Pray for those who persecute you? Jesus, let's just talk for a second. I barely pray for the people I like, let alone the people I don't like. You want me to take those colleagues, those neighbors, those aunts, those uncles, those family members that absolutely drive me crazy, and you want me to add them to my prayer list? Yeah. What's the alternative? figure out how to twist their arm to be more like you, good luck. Change them, good luck. And here's what I've discovered. When you're praying for somebody that you don't like, it's hard to continue not liking them. It's hard to hold bitterness against somebody you're consistently praying for. Because I've done this, okay? The first time you pray for somebody that persecutes you, it's a petty prayer, okay? It's what I call a petty prayer. Lord, did you just help them get a full-time job and quit living with their mom, whatever. And Lord, it's a petty prayer. It's a prayer, but it's a petty prayer, you know? But every now and then, the longer you pray for somebody, the sooner God will break your heart for that person. And then all of a sudden you start going, you know, maybe the reason they're offending me, maybe it doesn't have as much to do with me as I think it does. And then you start to shift and you start going, Lord, would you heal the parts of them that are broken the most? And Lord, would you bless them? And Lord, would you reveal yourself to them? And would you give them wisdom? And would you give them fresh vision for their life? And Lord, I pray that they would know that you have a purpose for them. You do that long enough. This is why I think Jesus is a genius. You do that long enough, and guess what happens? Maybe God answers their prayer, your prayer, and they change. But in the process, you change. And now you're a person that is not walking around with bitterness. Here's what I've learned about offenses. And I learned this from God. And when I found out that this was an option, I just went, oh, this is a game changer. Because this is how I think you can walk in forgiveness. This is how I think you can be unoffendable. Number four, decide to forgive people before they hurt you. Yeah, decide to forgive people before they hurt you. If you wait for the offense to decide your response, it's too late. Because you and I aren't that good. But if you make a decision ahead of time that says, I've already made a decision, I've already put a stake in the ground, I'm gonna be a forgiving person. And in fact, I might even expect them to be offensive at Thanksgiving, okay? Like I'm just waiting for it. And I've decided ahead of time, I'm gonna forgive them when it happens. I just love what Colossians says. It says, make allowance for each other's faults. Make allowance and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. I absolutely love the vocabulary here. Make allowance, leave margin. Keep a little bit of grace in your back pocket at all times for other people's faults. And here's why I think this verse is so clutch. It's because you and I must realize that we are all somebody's Colossians 3:13. Like, I know you were thinking of somebody when I read that verse out loud, but guess what? Somebody was thinking of you every time they read that verse. They go, man, Lord, would you give me the grace to make some space for them? We're somebody's them. And so this is a game changer. This is gonna change how you go to work. This is gonna change your whole week. This week, I want you to walk around and expect people to be offensive. Yeah, I want you to expect it. I want you looking for it. Yeah, Monday, is it you today? Is it gonna be you? Is it you? Is it you? You got something to say? I know you got something. I can see it on your face. You got an attitude. You ain't even said nothing. You brought the attitude into work. Okay, is it you? No. Tuesday, no. Wednesday, no. Thursday, bam, there you go. I've been waiting for you all week. What do you mean? It's like, yeah, I knew you were coming. Ryan told me I work with you. He said that it was gonna happen, and right on time, here you are with your offense, and guess what? I'm gonna give you what I wish somebody was giving me. Amazing grace, because I've already made a decision about my life. I've already made a decision about my holidays. I have already made a decision about my 2024. We keep letting offensive people take us off guard, and we are legitimately surprised when people say and do things that offend. I can't believe they would post it. Believe them, okay? Just believe them. Lower your expectations for humanity, okay? Why? Because we're all extremely flawed. Did you know that you're not just forgiven? Did you know that you are actually pre-forgiven? There's something you're going to do in the future. God has already made up his mind what he wants to do with your sins and your mistakes. He sent his son as an advanced loan for everything that you and I could ever do. It's why we call it good news. It's amazing news. So imagine if you and I decided to do that. Imagine if we could look at our spouses and go, hey, you're pre-forgiven. You're going to say something today. It's coming. I know. At some point, it's going to happen, okay? I don't know. It may not be today. Maybe tomorrow. But at some point, something's going to happen. I just want to let you know what my response is going to be. Why? And some, do you know the biggest step in forgiveness is not the actual forgiving. It's deciding that you want to. It's making the decision that says, I don't want to be an angry person. I don't want to be a resentful person. I don't want to be a bitter person. I want to make a decision that I want to live my life different. I want to encourage you today to forgive the people who hurt you the most. I know we can play the blame game. You only had 10% of the blame. They had 90%, and so you and I have these forgiveness prerequisites. I'll forgive them when? When what? When they apologize? Okay. Good luck with that. You're going to be waiting a very, very long time. And here's the good news this weekend. What if I told you, whatever person you envision being after they apologize, what if I told you you could be that person right now before they apologize? Imagine if by the time they come to apologize, you go, God already healed me of that. Forgiveness isn't about getting your healing from that person. It's about letting them off the hook and getting healing from a God who can actually do the healing. The apology might be nice, but it will not do for you what you think it will do for you. I have to implore you right now to be the kind of person that says, I really would rather hold on to this, but I'm making a decision to let it go. And I gotta give that to God. My father had a stroke when I was in the fifth grade, and then he had another one about 8 years ago. And then he was in hospice for about 2 years, and then he passed away. Here's what I would give anything to hear one more time. Want to go to Walmart? And I wouldn't park in the hazards. I'd park like a normal person and say, let's take our time. Let's walk up and down every aisle. I want you to forgive the people in your life that have hurt you because you might not have the chance to tomorrow. Tomorrow's not promised for any of us. And so I'm going to ask you to do something tough today. Maybe you got to make a tough phone call. Maybe you've got to send a tough text message. Maybe you've got to write a letter. Maybe you haven't been on speaking terms in a very, very long time. I'll never forget. A woman emailed me and she said, Ryan, I called my sister who I had not spoken to in 5 years today. And we both just burst into tears the minute she answered the phone. I think it's possible for things to be different. And some of you go, I haven't talked to them in so long. And people say, Ryan, what do I say? Well, how do you feel? I miss them. Start there. Hey, I miss you. I don't know where we went south. Maybe you've got to extend some forgiveness. If you really want to go to the next level, maybe it's somebody that you owe an apology to. To say, I'm just going to apologize for my part. I know we could play blame game. I know we could play the... there's nothing worse than apologizing to somebody that owes you one, and you apologize just so they can apologize. You're like, hey, I'm sorry. And then you kind of wait, and they go, thank you. You're like, oh, no. You are the one. This isn't about them being unoffendable. This is about you being unoffendable. This is about you walking in forgiveness. This is about you making a decision about the kind of person that you want to be, not just for an election year, but for your life. To say, hey, I've made a decision. I want to be more like Jesus in his house. And I want my house to mirror his house. Can you imagine if you and I stepped into the holidays, stepped into an election year, going, I've got some beliefs, I've got some opinions, but I think I can disagree without disrespect. I think I can have the ability to look someone in the eyes and be able to hear them out and listen to their perspective and love our community extremely well. And when somebody goes below the belt with me or shows some disrespect to me, I'm not going to be shocked that they did. But in that moment, I hope that you and I can do the thing that we all wish somebody was doing for us, and that's making allowance for our faults and our mistakes. And to be able to like, you know what? In this next season of our lives, may we be the kinds of people that give people a little bit of margin, that give them a little bit of space. And may we be the kinds of people that says, hey, I'm not impervious to offense. I'm not invincible. No. But I am the kind of person that I'm not going to sit there and dwell on what you said in the fifth grade and carry that in to the rest of my life. No, you said it in fifth grade, and guess what? I'm going to get over it in fifth grade. And you said it in 2022, and I'm going to leave that actually in 2022 and move on with my life, not because I have the strength to do it, but because I serve a Heavenly Father who extended me something that I did not deserve on my own. My prayer for you today is that as you make tough phone calls and craft tough text messages and emails and letters, is that the Holy Spirit of God would be with you and that he would give you the right words to say and that you wouldn't be so concerned about the outcome, that there would be this just romantic reconciliation and then that everybody's just crying, hugging each other. I don't know if that's gonna happen. It could. But this is about your heart. This is about you making a decision about the kind of person that you want to be. And I think that's a person that can truly be unoffendable. God, I thank you so much for this amazing church. I pray, God, that today as we walk, or at least try to walk in forgiveness, would you be with us? Would you give us the strength to do what we cannot do on our own, which is to let some things Would you truly help us be unoffendable as we make tough phone calls, as we craft tough messages? Would you give us the words to say? Would you give us your wisdom? And I pray that your peace would be in our relationships. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say
it. Amen. Amen. Thank God for Ryan Lee. Amen. Thank you, Ryan, for pouring into our body. I pray you've been blessed today, challenged, invited to step into pre-forgiveness. Ryan's going to be out in the lobby. His book, Unoffendable, is out there as well. But online and in this room, he's got several other books available, especially on leadership and all of the corporate world stuff and just personal development as well. So you can go to ryanleek.com and find more resources there. If you're new, we'd love to see you at the guest gathering or in the prayer room. Maybe you're reminded of some wounding in your heart today and you just want to connect with somebody and pray. We would love to connect with you and pray and just pray for a release within you, so you can take the next courageous steps towards people. We love you. God bless you. We'll see you back next weekend. We start a brand new series. I can't wait to start it with you. It's on Jesus and politics. So let's jump in. And so it'll be fun. We're going to get through it. So love y'all. We'll see you.
Well, what an incredible service and such a fun time to get to sing together and celebrate baptisms and open God's word. I hope that you were encouraged. And to be very candid with you, I don't know everything that he talked about because I was really getting to spend some time with Bodhi, celebrating him and our family. And And so I'm so glad we got to have that part of the service. But as we are thinking about this whole concept of living unoffendable and recognizing that as we walk with each other, as we live in the relationships that we have, there are plenty of opportunities to take offense, and there's an opportunity to forgive and to live unoffendable with the people that we're around. So I'd encourage you, especially as we move into our next series, where we're going to be looking at Jesus and politics, and what does it look like for you and me as believers in Christ to actually live in our culture, to live in our world that is so divided politically? And what would it look like for you and I to actually allow Jesus to live out through us in that space with the people that we are connected with? I'm praying for you, and I hope that you're having sent conversations. We would love to hear from you. If you're connecting with people and being intentional to share your faith, to even just ask spiritual questions or to let people know you're praying for them, we'd love to hear from you. You go to bentry.org/4000 so we can see a little bit of what's going on in your world and how you're experiencing your faith. I'm so thankful that you would take time to worship with us. It means a lot. And to me, it means that God's at work in your life. And so I just want to encourage you that he is with you in the middle of whatever you're going through. And I am so thankful that we get to worship together. And I can't wait for us to get to do it again next week. We'll see you then.